Hello everyone, I am Rohan Dasani and I am from the Department of Electrical Engineering, IIT Jodhpur, and in this video we will be covering A to Z about the pulse code modulation, which we also call PCM. Before we dive deep into what is pulse code modulation, the basic thing we should know is pulse code modulation is a digital modulation system. So the point is, why a digital communication system over an analog? Because all the naturally occurring signals are analog. Now, some key reasons to use digital communications are: the digital is much more robust and analog to noise and interference. Digital is much more efficient for bandwidth. Digital is easier to store, cheaper, and easier to multiplex several digital signals than analog signals. Now, the points like bandwidth and noise might look a bit complex to you, but don't worry, we'll be covering this individually in later part of the video. Now, what is pulse code modulation? Pulse code modulation is a method used to digitally represent sampled analog signals. It is a very standard form of digital audio in computers and many other digital audio applications. Now, if you look at the figure in the right, what we have just done is the sampling of the signals. But now, what values will be assigned to that samples and how will it be transmitted all comes under the pulse code modulation. So let us now look at the analog to digital conversion process. Now, what we do is we give the analog input to the ADC. ADC is nothing but the analog to digital converter. It is an acronym for that. Okay, so the first step is sampling. Now, sampling is a process of measuring the amplitude of a continuous time signal at discrete instants to convert it from a continuous signal into a discrete signal. Now, we can see in this figure that this was our real input, and what we just did is we took the samples at different instants of time. This is known as sampling. We use three different types of samplings. First is the ideal sampling, then natural sampling, and a flat top sampling. Now, in ideal sampling, what we do is we just take the samples at different instants of time, you can see, and just separate it by the time period TS. Second is the natural sampling, in which the samples actually follow the analog signal. And in third case, the flat top sampling, in which what we do is we take a sample at a particular instant of time and it stays for a while till we take the next sample. Okay? Then from sampling, we move on to our next step, that is quantization. Now, what quantization does, it makes the signal discrete in amplitude. What it means that it helps in rounding off the signal value into some particular or discrete levels that we have created according to the number of bits we have. And the next step is encoding. It means that after quantizing it or after assigning it a level, now we have to convert that signal into the digital output. Like the first signal here was pointing to around 111, and that conversion of this to 111 is known as encoding. So let us now look at the linear quantization. We start with an analog signal, which we can here see in the blue color, and suppose we call it M of T, and now we want to quantize it. So we know that our signal, the input signal, is limited from VL at minimum to VH at maximum. So if we consider an n-bit system, we can divide this whole range into L uniformly spaced intervals, where L would be given as 2 to the power n. For example, if we consider it 2 bits, then we can convert it into 4 levels. If we consider it a 3-bit system, then we can convert it into an 8-level system. Now, if you want to see the separation between two quantized levels, which we also call the step size, that will be given by the difference of the length between the maximum and minimum, divided by the number of levels that we have. So it will be given by VH minus VA upon L. Let us now look at the quantization error. Here the blue line represents our original signal and the red line represents our quantized signal. So if we look at the time instant 0.2, we know that the sample value was lying between 111 and 110, but in the sample value it is lying at 111. So we have introduced some error in our calculations. Okay, so if you look at the quantized waveform, which we denote as S star n, would be given by Sn plus Qn, where Sn would be the original sample value and Qn would be some quantization error that we have added and which we treat as noise. Now, if we relook at the previous diagram, we have just zoomed it to for better visualization. Now, what we can see is the maximum error that can be introduced with what we said as Q could be S by 2. It could either be in the negative side or it could either be in the positive side. So Q can uniformly be anywhere between minus S by 2 to S by 2. So if we assume that the bottom level is 0 and it goes till A max, so we can say that S would be A max by 2 to the power B. So let us now look at the root mean square quantization error. The root mean square quantization error would be given by 1 by s q square n integration from minus s by 2 to s by 2 dq. So this 1 by s will come out, and this q square n could be written as q cube n by 3 limit from minus s by 2 to s by 2. So this comes out to be s square by 12. So let us now look at the signal to noise ratio with quantization. The quantized waveform, which we modeled earlier, as s of n plus q of n. So as the name suggests, signal by noise ratio would be given by the mean square value of s upon mean square value of the noise. And we found the mean square value of noise is s square by 12 in the previous slide. So the mean square value of the signal would be given by m square into 1 by the separation, which is 2v. If we assume that vh and vl are equal, which is equal to, suppose say, v limit from minus v to v. So this comes out to be v square by 3. So if we take the ratio of v square by 3 and s square by 12, it comes out to be 2v by s whole square. And now if we see 2v is this total length, and each step size is s, and the number of steps is equal to 2 to the power n. So 2v is equal to s into 2 to the power n. So we find that s and r is equal to 2 to the power 2n. And if you find in dv, which we take 10 log 10 to the power 2n, it comes out to be 6.02n. So this means that the SNR ratio increases by around 6 dB with every increase in the number of bits. So we now have to decide what should we keep the quantization step value to minimize the error. So in the last slide, we derived the value of the root mean square error as s square by 12. So naturally, we will think that if s is kept small, the error will be small. So if we try to follow the same ideology and we keep smaller quantization steps, what we'll end up is increasing the number of bits in case we want to transfer a high amplitude. If you can see here, earlier this was the case, and if now we want to keep smaller quantization steps, we'll require a higher number of bits. So increasing the number of bits will make the system very slow. On the other hand, if we keep large quantization steps, the SNR ratio for the low amplitude pulse will be very less. If you see here, if we increase the quantization level value, we'll not be able to trace the change in the pulse. So we'll not be able to detect the change, and it will not be retrievable. It means what we are looking for is non-uniform quantization. It means that smaller quantization step for lower amplitude signals and larger quantization steps for high amplitude signals. So let us now make a side-by-side comparison that why we are doing a non-uniform quantization over uniform quantization. So what we want is that the levels should be closely spaced, or the step size should be small for lower amplitude signals to improve the SNR ratio. And for the higher amplitude signals, we want number of bits to be less, so we increase the size of the step. So this means that we want compression at the lower amplitude levels and expansion at the higher amplitude levels. So this compression and expansion is known as companding. The non-uniform quantizers are very difficult to make and are really expensive. So an alternative to this is that we pass the signal through non-linearity before quantizing it with a uniform quantizer. Now what we'll do is that it will cause the signal to be compressed. At the receiver, the signal is expanded by an inverse to the non-linearity we introduced for its retrieval. Now to see what we're actually doing, we are passing the analog signal to a compressor before encoding it, and then after the decoding, or for the decoder, we are passing it to the expander, which is exactly inversely proportional to the compression technique we used. So let us now look at two major laws of companding. First is the Mu law companding. This law is used in USA, Canada and Japan, and the output here is given by ln 1 plus mu x of t upon ln 1 plus mu, where x of t is our input and y of t is our output. Okay, we always use this in a normalized scale from 0 to 1. If you look at the uncompounded line here, what you can see is as the input increases, output also increases. But that is not what we want. What we actually want is that when the input is kept very small, the change in output should be significant. But as the amplitude increases and gets very high, we do not need that significant change in the output. And hence, the rate of change should decrease. So let us now look at A-law compounding. An A-law algorithm is a standard algorithm which is used in European 8-bit PCM digital communication systems. In this, the output is given by A mod x of t upon 1 plus ln A if x of t is lying between 0 and 1 by A. Now, If we consider the standard value of 87.56, we can see that 1 by A's value would be very small. And in this small range, we want the slope or the increase to be very high. And that is what we can see here. So if we look in the range of 1 by A to 1, what we actually want is that the rate of change should not be very high. So the increasing value or the rate of increase actually decreases as we move ahead in amplitude. Now, having the data from the quantizer, our next step would be encoding before final transmission. So we have completed the quantizer and now we'll be encoding it. So for that, we use line coding. Line coding is a method by which we convert the digital data into digital signals that is used for transmission. Or in very simpler words, line coding is a method of using a pulse to represent 0 and 1, that is the digital data. So here is our input stream, and using line coding, it has been converted into the digital signals. So now comes the point, why line coding? There are many different reasons for using line coding. Each of the different line codes that we will see will offer one or more of the following advantages. Well, we can completely eliminate the DC component. The DC component constitutes of no signal and it is just a wastage of power. It has error detection capabilities which might happen during transmission. And bandwidth usage. At the same bandwidth, using different line codes, there is a possibility of transmitting higher data rate than others. Now we should see the types of line coding. There are four major types of line coding. First, NRZ, which you also call as non-return to zero. Second, RZ, return to zero. Third, AMI, alternative mark inversion. And fourth is the Manchester code. So let us now look at all of these types one by one. First is the unipolar non-return to zero. In this type of unipolar signaling, high in the data is represented by a positive pulse and low in data means it has no pulse. Well, this is the clock and this is the data stream which has to be converted. So we know that 1 has to be represented by a positive pulse. So it is represented by a positive pulse at plus V volts. And when it is 0, it means nothing. We have to pass nothing, no pulse. Let us now look at the advantages and disadvantages of this line code. Well, main advantage is it is fairly simple. We know that when there is 1, we just simply need to pass a plus V, and when there is 0, we'll pass a 0. Okay? And a very less bandwidth is required in this case. But the main disadvantage is here that we cannot do any error detection. It means that we thought that we were transmitting 101, but it might have received say 111. So we have no way that we can detect if there was an error or not. So no clock is present and loss of synchronization is likely to occur, especially when there is a continuous long string of 1s and 0s. So next is unipolar return to zero line code. In this type of unipolar signaling, a high data is represented by a high pulse and its duration is less than the bit duration. What I mean is that we can see that here 1 is supposed to be for TS and its code representation. The signal reaches to high value, stays there for some time and comes back to zero. This is what is meant by return to zero. And again for zero, it remains zero. So let us now look at the advantages and disadvantages of this line code. Again, it is fairly simple, just like the previous code. For one, we represent a high value and for zero, it remains zero. So it is very easy to represent. Also, the spectral line present can be used as a clock. Now the main disadvantage again here is that there could not be any error correction. We cannot detect if the code that we have received is right or not. And we know that this is occupying less time. So it means that it will require more bandwidth. So it requires twice the bandwidth of non-return to zero line code. So the next type of line code is polar non-return to zero code. In this type of code, high is represented by a positive pulse that we're doing in the previous case also, and now the low is not represented by a zero, it is actually represented by a negative pulse. So here we have zero, minus V and plus V, both are present now. So when there is a positive pulse, it will go to the high or plus V, and if it is zero, it will go to minus V. Now we can understand this is if suppose there is some noise, then it might result in an undesired value. Zero might result in one because of noise. So to avoid that, we use a minus V. So let us now look at the advantage and disadvantage of this line code. Advantages, again, it is very fairly simple. But the main point is no low frequency components are actually present in this line code. And now looking at the disadvantages, again, we cannot do any error detection. No clock is present. And the main problem here is signal drooping that happens. But the point is, what is signal drooping? Now, drooping occurs when there is a long stream of ones the channel behaves as a filter and the output starts to degrade. What it means is, ideally we would have thought that it should be a straight line, a constant line of one. But because of the filter nature, what happens is the output starts to degrade. So this is known as drooping. So the next type of line code is polar RZ or polar return to zero. Well, high end data is represented by a Mach pulse or high pulse, and its duration is less than the bit duration. You can see here that half of the bit duration remains high and then it immediately comes down to zero. And for the low input, a negative pulse represents the data, and again it is of the half duration of the input data. So now the advantages and disadvantages of this code are that no low frequency components are actually present in this code. And the disadvantages are, again, there is no error correction, there is no clock present, and just like the unipolar case, it occupies the twice of the bandwidth of the polar NRZ line code. So the next type of line code is known as Manchester signaling. In this type of line code, what we do is that 1 is represented as a negative in first half and positive in second half, and 0 is represented as positive in first half and negative in second half. Like you can see here, 0, a positive first and then negative, and in 1, a 0 first and then positive. Now, this representation may differ from author to author, this might be opposite, okay? So for visualization, if the data is 1, we can see here that it is first 0 in the half cycle and then 1 in the next cycle. And in case of 0, it is 1 in the first half and 0 in the next half, okay? So let us now look at the advantage and disadvantages of this line code. Advantages: there is no DC component present because we know that it is opposite in the two half cycles, so the net DC component is always zero. It doesn't suffer from signal droop because it is always false when there is a long string of one, which is not present in this case because of its alternating nature, and it is very easy to synchronize. But the main disadvantage is that because of high number of transitions, it occupies a very large bandwidth. Also, it doesn't have any error detection capability. So the last type of code is known as alternative Mach inversion or AMI. Now in this, what we use is three different states, plus A, 0 and minus A. The state 0 represents no pulse, and whenever we encounter a state 1, it always has to be alternates of plus A and minus A. By that, what we mean is, like we can see here 1, initially it was supposed to say plus A, then next time when we encounter 1, it has to be minus A. Again, when next is 1, we get plus A. So it is always the alternative nature. That is why it is known as alternative Mach inversion. And for 0, it always remains 0. So now the biggest advantage of AMI code is because of its alternative nature, code for 1 is always alternating. So there is never a long string of 1s present in the code. Okay, so we avoid drooping in that case, and also there is no DC component present. So now coming towards the end of the presentation, we'll not be looking at the power spectral density. Now suppose we have a signal G of T with Fourier transform capital G of T. Now the subscript T here denotes that it is a finite duration. We know that the power of GT, suppose say in the Fourier domain, would be given by minus infinity to infinity mod of the Fourier transform square DF. Okay, and the power spectral density is actually defined by limit t tending to infinity, this pg upon t. Now we'll not be looking at the derivation for individual line codes, but we'll be looking at the visual representation of different line codes, the power spectral density for different line codes. Like for the bipolar NRZ, we can see that the power spectral density is really very concentrated. Okay, now for the polar NRZ, we know that the bandwidth seems to be very high and the power spectral density is very much distributed. Similarly, for the Manchester, the bandwidth is relatively smaller than the polar NRZ and it is also distributed. Okay, so depending on the cost of communication, the quality of signals we want, we choose the line code and we use that. So at the end, I want to tell you that most of the source of information in this video was from Geeks for Geeks and the book Communication System by B.P. Lattie. Thank you so much.